fine print, drip, drip. And Naaman went in and told the king of Aram what the Israel girl said. But I bet you he only told the king headlines. Whether he did or not, I know the only thing the king heard was headlines. Israel, cure, can I go? Headlines. And his perception was, number one, that if anybody had the power to cure a condition, it had to be political power. You missed that. You missed it. Look, he sent him to the king of Israel. He sent him to the king. So it had to be, no. What the king of Aram thought is that what some of us, same thing some of us think, and that is that politics and political solutions, politicians have got the cure for what it is that ails us. You missed it again. Somebody sitting right here this morning thinks that there is a political solution to the spiritual condition that has this country sick unto death. We think that if we can keep affirmative action alive, a political solution. We think that if we can just get the right folk in, get these racist Republicans out of office and get us some liberal Democrats into office, a political solution. Don't forget, it was the same white so-called liberal Democrats who switched to the Republican Party to try to keep Harold Washington out of office. Same ones y'all running up to and licking up behind right now, but that's another sermon. Some of us think if we can just get an honest dialogue going about race, because the president suggested a political solution, and the Asians the president put on the commission don't want to talk about the deep-seated hatred that whites have for blacks, nor the problems that slavery has left us as a legacy. Political solutions cannot cure the sickness that is killing this country little bit by little bit. The king's perception was that if anybody had the power to cure a terrible condition, it had to be another king. So he sent Naaman to the king of Israel. Now the girl said, preacher. And Ms. Naaman said, preacher. And Naaman probably said, preacher, if he had a byline under his headlines or if he was listening. And you know, men, we don't listen to the fine print. We want y'all to hurry up and get to the point. Like we need to say, I don't know what my point is. I'm coming to it. I'll work it. I'll know it when I get there. But all the king heard of Aram was the Israel. So he sent Naaman a letter and some material things to the king of Israel. Perception number two. Look what he did. Money can buy whatever you need. Money can fix this problem. Money talks, BS walks. Money is the answer for whatever the sickness is. And some of us are right there with the king. That is our perception. If we only had more money, if we only paid Michael, Scotty, and Dennis and Phil more money, if only we paid school teachers more money, if only our welfare folk could work and make money, we think money will solve our marital problems. We think money will solve our parenting problems. One member told me this week, my child's parent is a money parent. I said, what that means? Whatever we need, we got it. Whatever we think we need, he'll get it. Whatever we say we need, he will give it. But my child, the parent said to me, needs to be with her daddy, have conversation with her daddy, get counsel from her daddy, love from her daddy, and have the company of her daddy. Money can't take the place of a person or a parent. I don't care how much money you make or how much money you give. The perception is that money is the answer. But the reality is sometimes we need much more than money. Money can't buy you joy. Money can't buy you good health. Money can't buy you a marriage. It can buy you a wedding license, but it can't buy you any marriage that's fulfilling or mutually rewarding. Money can buy you a house, but money can't buy you a home. Money can't buy you real love. Money can't buy you peace of mind. The perception is that money is the answer. But the reality is that sometimes we need much more than money. But the king of Aram thought that money was the answer. Material things were the answer. Look what he did. The king sent a boatload of bucks. Look at it. 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of Armani, Versace, Givenchy, and Brioni. But what the king sent, money didn't have the power to fix what was wrong with Naaman. Even the Israelite girl had a misperception, and I skipped over her false perception. Come on back to verse 2 and look at what she said. If only my Lord were with the prophet, the preacher who's in Samaria, he could cure him of his leprosy. Her perception was that the preacher could do the curing. You missed that one too. Her perception was that the preacher could solve the problem. The preacher could fix what was broken. The preacher, in other words, had the power. And some of us live right on the same street that she lives on. We think the preacher can fix what's wrong with us. And if we don't get it from this preacher, we go run into some other preacher. We switch preachers, some of us, like we flipping channels, running from one preacher to the next. T.D. Jakes, clicker, clicker, click. Creflo Dollar, clicker, clicker, click. Bishop Brazier, clicker, clicker, click. Frederick K.C. Price, clicker, clicker, click. Jeremiah Wright, clicker, clicker, not too black. Charles Stanley, clicker, clicker, not too white. Apostle Mitchell, Apostle Turner, clicker, clicker, not too much, too little, too late. We think the answer lies with the preacher. We think the answer lies within the preacher. We think the power lies within the preacher. That's the perception. But the reality is that the power is not in the preacher. The power is not in the president. The power is not in politics. The power is not in your possessions. The power is not in the pulpit or popularity. Who's got the power? Look at verse 7 in the text. Look at verse 7. The king of Israel puts his finger on the power source. The king of Israel points us to the power supply. The king of Israel lets us know who's got the power. He says, and he is right, only God has the power. God's got the power to give life. God's got the power to change life, and God's got the power to sustain life. God's got the power to heal. God's got the power to help. God's got the power to hold you. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Don't put your trust in politics. The political system may fail you. Put your trust in God. Don't put your trust in possessions. Your possessions can be taken away from you. Put your trust in God. Don't put your trust in us preachers. Freddie Haynes may let you down. Jeremiah Wright will let you down. Us preachers are finite and flawed, hellish fellows representing an infinite and flawless heavenly Father. Us preachers ain't nothing but insignificant nobodies trying to tell everybody about a sweet certain somebody who can still save anybody. We ain't the message. We are just the messengers. Don't put your trust in preachers. Preachers may fail you, but God never fails. Put your trust in God. I ain't got no power. But he... Y'all don't believe me? Come here, Isaiah. Come on, help me. See, we need some power. We need overcoming power. We need doubt-destroying power. We need community-building power. We need economic development power. We need life-changing power. We need child-raising power. We need marriage-saving power. Headline, fine print, compromising power. We need loving power, even when it ain't easy. Loving you anyhow kind of power. We need the power that only God can give. I ain't got that power. I'm sorry, you're going to have to click, 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 turn some other station. But wherever you turn, they ain't got it either. Listen to Isaiah. Step up here to the mic, Isaiah.